Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Winecast. If you've been following this cast, you might remember that back in December of last year, I did a cast on latitude and wine. And in that cast, I had a section on the significance of vineyard slope and aspect and how they relate to latitude. Well, it's confession time, and I'm here to confess that I'm not happy with that section of that cast. Some, maybe most of what I said was solid, but let me be the first to say that my understanding of vineyard slope and aspect has improved measurably since I did that cast. And as I'm committed to getting you the best and most accurate information that I have at my disposal, I feel like I need to update that section of that cast and expand it. So rather than reissue the whole cast, I'm going to redo that section here as a separate cast. If you want, you can think of this cast as an addendum to the Wine and Latitude cast, and I hope it leaves you with a better understanding of what the lay of a vineyard's land brings to the table when it comes to growing grapes and making wine. So let's get started, and like we did with the first cast, let's imagine a stretch of vineyards in a region at a high northerly or southerly latitude, let's say 45 degrees north. And let's imagine that the grapes in this region are planted on both flat ground and slopes. At the beginning of summer, June in the northern hemisphere, but December if we're down in the south, the sun is riding high in the sky and all of the grapes, no matter where they are, will be getting lots and lots of sunshine. But by the time harvest rolls around, usually sometime in late September or March depending on the hemisphere, thanks to the tilt of the earth on its axis, the sun will have crept lower in the sky. Now, here's where things got sketchy in my last cast. I said that vines on the flat ground wouldn't be getting as much sun exposure as vines on the slope, and that's true. But then I said the reason why is because vines on the flat ground are partly obscured and in the shadow of other vines. Unfortunately, while that may happen sometimes, I suppose, that's really not what's going on here. And this is where I've got to make some corrections. The best way to express the situation is to say that the vines on flatter ground aren't getting as much radiant energy from the sun as the vines on the slope, and here's the reason why. Since we're imagining things, let's imagine a flat piece of ground, and then let's imagine a beam of sunlight, about a mile wide, hitting it at a 90-degree angle, like it would close to the equator. Because it's coming straight down, perpendicular to the ground, it'll cover an area exactly equivalent to its width, a mile wide. But now imagine a second beam of sunlight, also a mile wide, but this time hitting the Earth at a 30-degree angle, like it would at a higher latitude north or south. Now, something different happens here. Instead of covering an area 1 mile wide, the beam ends up covering an area twice as wide at 2 miles. Both beams of sunlight are the same size and have the same amount of radiant energy from the sun. But in the case of the second beam, the radiant energy is spread over a larger area because of the angle it's coming in at. And so the energy is weaker than when coming from directly overhead. This is the main reason why it's hotter at the Earth's equator than it is when you approach either of the poles, and, in a smaller way, why the sun feels more intense in the middle of the day when it's riding higher in the sky than at dusk when it's lower in the sky. So if we go back to our imaginary wine region with its sloped and flat vineyards, you can see that when the sun is highest in the sky, the very beginning of summer, all the grapes will be getting roughly equally concentrated amounts of radiant energy from the sun. Yes, the slide is exaggerated for simplicity. Look, there's a limit to how much math I'm willing to do after all. And you wouldn't get a situation that really looked like this unless you were pretty close to the equator. But the basic point is still sound. The higher the sun rides in the sky, the closer all the grapes come to getting more or less the same concentration of radiant solar energy. But if we fast forward to the end of the growing season, when the sun is lower in the sky, a different picture emerges, again exaggerated for simplicity, with the vineyards on the flat ground getting more diffuse radiant energy than the vineyards on the slope, where the radiance is more concentrated. And this is exactly what's going on in Burgundy, with the Grand Cru vineyards generally occupying a sweet spot on the Côte d'Or, or Golden Slope, while the Premier Cru vineyards occupy a slightly less sweet spot, and so on for the village and regional vineyards, with the relative sweetness of the spots correlated to the concentration of radiant solar energy that the spot the grapes are on gets over the course of the growing season. How much difference does a slope make in practical terms? Well, if we go back to our imaginary vineyard at 45 degrees north, and we go there early in the season, say on the summer solstice when the sun is highest in the sky, you can see that the slope makes a modest difference with the concentration of radiant energy going up as the slope does. But if we stay in the same vineyard but wait until the sun is lower in the sky, say at the end of summer, then the amount of slope begins to make a much bigger difference in the radiant energy that a site on a hill can get. All of this is complicated by the fact that any slope will make a bigger difference the higher the latitude. So if we head up to 50 degrees north, or south if we were in the southern hemisphere, where roughly Canada's Okanagan Valley and Germany's Mosel are, a 15 degree slope will result in more concentration of heat energy than it would have at 45 degrees, home to the Willamette Valley as well as Bordeaux and the northern Rhone. And we'd find the same lessening of concentration as we hit 40 degrees, and then 35, and finally 30, at the bottom end of what's usually thought to be the best latitudes for growing grapes for quality wine production. You may have noticed that the charts I've been using max out at 15 degree slope. That's because once you get beyond 15 degrees, it becomes more and more difficult to manage vines. Because of the danger of rollover as well as other issues, mechanical harvesters are usually out of the question beyond 15 degrees, and at a certain point, human harvesters have to begin wearing harnesses and other equipment to be able to harvest the grape safely. Burgundy's Côte d'Or, probably the world's most famous grape growing slope, just to make the point, has about a 13 degree slope at its steepest. I've definitely exaggerated, for both simplicity and effect, the degree of the slope on the slides I've been using in this cast, so here's a more accurate visual of what we're talking about. If we take this burgundy colored rectangle to represent flat ground, then a 15 degree slope, a little steeper than the Côte d'Or, would look like this. And as for the world's steepest vineyard, as far as anyone can tell, that's the Calmont vineyard, far to the north, no surprise, in Germany's Mosel, with a 65 degree slope that would look something like this. At that angle, you need a monorail to get field workers safely to the vines for harvest, and if you want to see what that looks like, check the information section for this video where I've linked to a video of it as well as, for reference sake, another video of what it looks like to climb up a 30 degree slope. Also, in addition to direct sunlight exposure, slopes allow the vines on them to pick up sunlight indirectly, reflected off of the flat ground facing the slope. How much light gets from the ground to the slope will depend on the albedo, or surface reflectance, of the ground facing the slope. Albedo represents a proportion of radiant energy that's reflected from the ground and is measured on a scale between 0, representing no reflected energy at all, and 1, representing a reflection of all energy. The lighter a surface appears, the higher its albedo. So while most dark soils have a low albedo of about 0.17, very sandy soils will have an albedo closer to 0.4, and very chalky soils, like the Albariza soils found in the Jerez region of southern Spain, clock in at around 0.5. For the sake of comparison, snow, depending on how fresh it is and other factors, will have an albedo of around 0.8 to 0.9, which is why it's important to wear eye protection when out skiing and such. Reflection of radiant energy onto a slope is just a very large-scale version of what happens in vineyards all over the world when the soil of the vineyard reflects a portion of the radiation that missed the vines back onto them, helping to ripen the grapes. And it's one of the factors in trying to determine the best soils on which to plant grapes, with slow, late-ripening grapes in cool climates, for example, benefiting from soils with relatively high albedo. So far, all we've talked about is slope, but we need to say just a little bit about aspect. In wine growing, aspect refers to the orientation of hillside vineyards relative to the points of a compass. So if a vineyard is on the south side of a hill, it has a southern aspect, and those on the north side have a northern aspect. In the northern hemisphere, the south side of a hill will get a higher concentration of radiant energy from the sun per unit of area than the north side, as you can see here. So in the northern hemisphere, especially at high latitudes, vineyards with southern aspect are usually favored over those with northern aspect as good places to make sure the grapes get ripe. But if for various reasons a wine grower wants to limit the sun exposure of the grape she's growing, then northern aspect is the ticket. In the southern hemisphere, all of this flips, and it's the vineyards with northern aspect that are prized for their sun exposure. Finally, how about western and eastern aspect? Vineyards with eastern aspect, that is, ones that face east no matter what the hemisphere, get the sun first in the day, and so are often drier as dew and rain evaporate, sooner than vineyards with western aspect, reducing the chances that they may suffer from rot or other vine diseases. But western aspect vineyards generally get warmer than their eastern counterparts, so they do get a bump in terms of grape ripening. Of course, wine growers don't get to custom order the landscapes that their grapes grow on, and they're limited to what the terrain in an area has to offer. So most of the world's sloped vineyards don't have a simple north, south, east, or west aspect, but some combination of two of them, like a southwest aspect, for example. Are there other benefits to slope and aspect than just exposure to radiant solar energy? Yes, but we can cover those in another cast. Thanks for joining me for this cast, though. I went into this cast, as shown by the last time I tackled this subject, with pretty limited knowledge about the significance of slope and aspect, especially the former. And now I'm considerably better informed than I was, and I hope this cast left you in the same place. This is a technical subject, and I'm not an expert on it by any means, so if there are gaps in my understanding or just points that could use clarification, please don't hesitate to let me know. I'm absolutely committed to presenting the most accurate information that I can on these casts, and I'm willing to keep making corrections until I get it right. Thanks again for watching, and as always, for liking, subscribing, and commenting. I'm your host, The Unknown Winecaster, and I'm out. Enjoy the grape, but always enjoy it responsibly.